of this to the restaurant before we offer it started. God bless you all on this nice, crisp winter morning. And for those of you who watch this from home, we love you. God loves you. We hope and pray that all will be well for you today and always. God bless you today. Welcome, beautiful children of God. Love one another. Take care of each other. Let's begin with announcements. Ruth?
I just wanted to let the ladies know that I just signed up for February for our dinner. I'm thinking Rosaria's in Perrysburg, but the date and time to be determined. Brad has to go to the surgeon on Tuesday, so he's probably going to have surgery, so we have to work around that. But I will let you know. Look for a sign-up sheet next Sunday.
Okay.
Thank you, Ruth. Yes, Jude?
How is your beloved?
I will share about how my beloved is during joys and concerns, but let me just say, better and better. Are there others? Let's open our hearts to God in prayer and thanksgiving, and to each other in love and caring.
Thank you.
Karina so much for what she does. Wonderful.
First Corinthians 12 tells us that you need me and I need you. We all need each other and we all need Christ.
Spend very little time actually looking at themselves. actually paying any attention to themselves. In fact, most of them will go through a good bit of their lives distracting themselves from themselves. So he called to stop and take a look inside yourself. He called that the undiscovered country. And he said we would all do better if we took a good look inside ourselves. That's Carl Jung, the psychiatrist. Siddhartha Gautama, the Buddha, he said in a Satipatthana Sutta, this is the only way monks, some translations say this is the direct way, this is the only way monks for the purification of beings, for the overcoming of sorrow and lamentation, for reaching the right path, for the attainment of nirvana, namely the four foundations of mindfulness. What are the four foundations? And then he says it's the body, the feelings, the mental frame, and the stream running through the mind. And then his thing is that if you really look at yourself, really look at what's going on in there, in your body and in your feelings and your frame of mind and your thought stream, you can learn something. And it's a liberating something. That there's something about the mirror inside that does us good. Did any of you look in the mirror this morning before coming to church? Did you make sure, you know, things were just so? I hope you did. The spiritual truth is that we need to take a look at an interior mirror, if you will. So you don't just look outside at, is my hair in the right place? But you look on the inside. How's my heart? How am I on the inside right now? My children used to say to me sometimes, Dad, you're angry. And I would say, no, I'm not. They could see inside me better than I could. And that may be the case. There's a Yiddish saying that when three people say you're drunk, lie down. Sometimes people can see you better than you can see yourself. But look into yourself. Know yourself. That's an important part of growing up as a Christian. Last week I spoke how there was an initiation when God said to Jesus at his baptism, you are my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And I told all of you, as children of God, that you are God's beloved child as well. And so the question is, isn't that nice? Now what? Now what? What does God want from you as a child? When you're a child and company comes to the house, your task is to take care of the company. When you're in somebody else's house, your job is to receive things politely and not make a fool of yourself and not be greedy. But there's a difference between being company and being family. When you're family, you're part of the team that gives hospitality. And so God wants you to be part of the team that gives hospitality in the world. Let's say this is God's house. This is God's world. And you're God's family. So you are not a guest. You are part of the family that's taking care of things. Welcome to my father's house, my mother's house. I'm so glad you're here. How can I be kind to you today? Well, it's easier to be kind when we are cleaned up on the inside. Remember the show, there was different ones, that the American Idol is one where people would sing. And do they occasionally, I don't really watch it, but I think I've seen it a few times where someone gets on there and they're a terrible singer. And I've used this illustration before. And they say to them, why are you even here? Because they thought they were a good singer. But, and maybe their friends were embarrassed to tell them, no, you're not, because they didn't want to hurt their feelings. So they were going through life thinking that they were a good singer when really they weren't. Well, let's apply this to the things of the soul. You think you're loving and joyful and patient and kind. You think you're all those things? Maybe you're not. And so to be able to take the time to look within is a purification process, is a self-awareness process which can help you not grate on other people's hearts. And to know yourself and to know the grace of God directly. Taking the time to go out into the wilderness. When Jesus was baptized, it says right after that, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He was led by the Spirit of God, the Spirit of God, into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He needed to go through this time of clarification. And I'm going to suggest that we all could use some time of clarification so that we see who we really are and we know who we can be and who we should be. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. But he answered, it is written. There are so many lessons in this scripture. One of them is that temptations can be pretty indirect. He doesn't say, turn these stones to bread. He says, if you are the Son of Man, and people will do that to you. They'll say, if you're a real man, do this. Or if you're a real woman, do that. You say, wait a minute, I'm a real man, I can do that. But you might be falling for something. So he says, if you are the Son of God, turn these stones to bread. Well, we believe Jesus is the Son of God, but he wasn't going to do the devil's bidding here. He said, it is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. A quotation of scripture. Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. And now, not only has he said, if you are the Son of God, but has added scripture to it. And so you can be tempted by misreading of scripture even. So careful, careful out there in the clarification. Jesus said to him, again it is written, you do not put the Lord your God to the test. Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, all these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. There are many false gods out there, friends, those things which wish to become absolute in your life, to be put first in your life, not God first, but them first. And to be careful, because these can be good things, but this is not the great thing. You worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. So those are the three temptations of Jesus according to the Gospel of Matthew. And what do they mean? Could there have been a different three? Why these three? And why this order? In the Gospel of Luke, the order is different. I chose this one because I really like the order of Matthew. And as I've been praying for this sermon and preparing, I thought about mental illness. And I thought about stones to bread being like hoarding. Have you ever seen hoarding? I knew at least one hoarder. I would go to visit her, and she had the basically trash and stuff piled up, so there was just a little pathway going through from one part of her residence to another, and everything was so dirty I didn't want to eat there. You know, it was difficult. Her hoarding was pretty obvious, but I've heard there's people who hoard money, for example. They can never get enough. It's like they would live in piles and just walk between the piles. And so there's hoarding. Now, having things is not bad, but there's an obsession, there's an overdoing, there's a seeking it as security and an addiction to it. And then throwing yourself from the temple, making a big show is a kind of narcissism. So it could be like, it's all about me, 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 me. Are you done talking about you? Because I want to talk about me some more. And it's all a need to be the center of attention. And that could be the throwing from the temple. And then I thought about obsessive compulsive, possibly for that power and control. If I'm not controlling it, it's out of control. And so you can become a control aficionado. You can be obsessive about that. But brothers and sisters, these are illnesses. To seek security endlessly instead of trusting in God, because no matter who you are going to get old and sick and die. Things are going to go away from you, and you need to know that you're going to be all right, because there is a peace that passes understanding. There is a transcendence. And you need to know it's not all about you, that other people are just as real as you are and deserve to be treated with dignity, just like you want to be treated with dignity. And so no need to climb up on any pillars and jump off of them and make a show of things, but to be just out there in the world and not to need to control everything and micromanage and tell other people how to live their lives. Just clean up your own life. And so these temptations are things that you can see if you go to the undiscovered country. If you take some time to see inside yourself. The beautiful thing is that when we take some time to do this, things seem to somewhat naturally unhook over time, and we get somewhat better. Now, this is not for everyone, I will say. I know one man who has a physical malady that whenever he holds still and gets quiet and turns within, he's overwhelmed by a certain sensation on his skin that he usually gets to ignore. He has a terrible time meditating because of that, or doing centering prayer or something like that. And then there's people like my mother who said, tried it, didn't work. And she probably... she's got no patience for this. And you may be like my mother and have no patience for this. People are different, and for some people, it's like this thing that I'm teaching now is like, oh yeah, I want to do that, I really enjoy that. And there's for others, it's like, no, I'd rather go and fix something for someone who needs something fixed. I would rather go and I would rather worship God and get lost in some beautiful music. So there's different ways of being. But if you don't look within, you might not just be hurting yourself, but you might be going through the world somewhat stupidly and hurting others because you don't see how your own obsessions are out there. And I believe we all have them. Religion is more caught than taught. People won't really care about what you say as much as they'll care about how much you care. They will. Religion is more caught. It's show and tell, not just tell. Show and tell. And what are we showing? We're showing faith, hope and love, faithfulness, encouragement and love. That's what the world needs. That's what we need. And that's what we need to cultivate and grow within ourselves. It's in you, because God is with you and in you. This is not something that is alien to you. This is a deep part of your nature as a human being. As a human being, you also have selfishness and greed and sloth, and so do I. We all have our own constellation of sins and troubles. But we also all have love, joy, and peace in there. This divine presence is in us, and we need it, and the world needs it. So, there's a war today, there's a war tomorrow. There are people dying of hunger, there are murders on the streets, and there probably will be tomorrow too. And you may not be able to do anything about that except pray and organize, but what can you do? You can clean up your own life by shining and basking in God's light, and then you can pour that love out through you to every person you meet in a divine appointment. I was sitting at Doc Watson's next to a Lutheran. I was there to watch some soccer, and I was introduced, and they said, "He's a pastor." I'm drinking my coffee. I've got nothing against beer and wine, by the way, but I drink coffee. And I was sitting there drinking my coffee and eating my lunch and watching soccer on the telly. And I was told that this was a Lutheran beside me. And she said, "Well, I used to go to church, but it just seems so much like nothing goes on. You know, there's just so many things wrong with the world, and there isn't much that I can do." And I said, "What about divine appointments?" And by that I said, "Maybe I was supposed to be sitting next to you right now. And you were supposed to be sitting next to me right now. And maybe this is that all we can do is try to show each other. We may not be able to fix the world, but can we bring love and kindness to each other right now?" She was like, yes, she could. And then I said, "And what if not just this is a divine appointment, but what about the next person you see is also a divine appointment, and the next one, and the next one?" Beautiful children of God, Jesus went from one divine appointment to another his whole life, and so do you. And so do you. Jesus did not stop wars. He preached against them. He preached about forgiving and loving your enemies. But wars kept on going. But what did Jesus do? He did something you can also do. He recognized everything, every person as a divine appointment. Every person, someone to love and care for. And so why did you go out into the wilderness, and why should you take some time to look inside? To prepare yourself, to clear yourself out, so that you can wake up to the reality that you are in a divine lifetime, a lifeline, and you are going to have opportunities today to show love and speak truth. So, beautiful children of God, I encourage you, whether you're an active type or a quiet type, to take a few breaths every day to look within. Get to see your undiscovered country. You will be less likely to harm others with your illnesses, and God will be in a place to heal you day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year, for our whole lifetimes. We return to our wilderness because we always need God's cleansing so we can be an outpouring vessel of God's love. Amen.
Thank you.
have spent time within being cleansed so that each appointment can be well met. And when we fail, we can take that to God and be well met again next time. Let's read the benediction scripture. Which commandment is the most important of all?
Jesus answered, the most important is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.
And all God's people say,
Amen.
Yeah.